Macmillan Audio presents That's What Fashion Is. Lessons and stories from my nonstop, mostly glamorous life and style. By me, Joe Zee. This is the author. Introduction. I will never forget the night I learned that Oscar de la Renta had died. There are a few reasons for this. The first, of course, is that Mr. de la Renta was and always will be a fashion legend, a man who dressed thousands of VIW, very important women, including all the first ladies of recent history, from Jackie Kennedy to Michelle Obama, to Oscar winners and chart-topping pop stars. He was also a personal inspiration to me, so his death was an even deeper loss. Mr. De La Renta's reputation throughout the fashion world was unwavering. He was always gracious and welcoming, no matter who you were. In essence, a true gentleman. He was classy and classic, and working with him, which I did on a number of occasions, including twice in the Dominican Republic, his home country, and several times back in New York, was always a rich and rewarding experience. From Mr. De La Renta, I learned how to treat people and what sophistication and style truly meant. And yes, he was always Mr. De La Renta to me. And not because he insisted on that formality, but because I had so much respect for the regal way with which he approached fashion. But really, despite all my memories of his remarkable character, that night was also another example, for me, of all my worlds coming seamlessly together. A world where I would again balance everything I love to do. It was a fairly calm and quiet evening back in October 2014, when I found out about Mr. De La Renta's death in a fairly unconventional way, even for me. A few years earlier, I might have read about it online in my morning news feed. Now I was the one helping to create that morning news feed. 5 months prior, I'd left ELLE magazine and accepted a new position as editor-in-chief of Yahoo Style, where I set about launching a new digital fashion magazine for one of the world's largest tech companies. There, my vision was to marry my favorite conventions from my vast print experience, original photography, shooting covers, and bold, provocative imagery with a quick practicality of the web, delivering real news, story that captivate the reader in real time. That October night, my site, Yahoo Style, had been live for close to a month when I got that call. Breaking news for us, up until that point, had consisted mainly of Fashion Week coverage and store openings. Mr. De La Renta's passing would be a different story. It was 6 p.m. and I was driving through Los Angeles from Beverly Hills, where I'd been doing an interview for an upcoming story, to downtown L.A., racing to meet my friend Sophia Amoruso, the founder and CEO of Nasty Gal and an entrepreneurial hero for young girls, for dinner. For those who know anything about the layout of L.A. and its massive traffic pattern during rush hours, you know that crossing from Beverly Hills to downtown at that time, especially on a freeway, is strictly reserved for those brave souls with patience and stamina. So I was already on edge and fretting about arriving late to dinner when my cell phone rang through my car's Bluetooth. It was Anderson Cooper's office. "Hello?" said the sweet but somewhat frantic producer on the other end of the line. "I'm calling from CNN, and I wonder if you can confirm for us that Oscar de la Renta had died. Do you know if that's true?" "Confirm? True? Died?" I can still hear those words ringing in my ears. I remember thinking, I have no idea. And though I knew Mr. De La Renta had been ill on and off, I had believed that he was on the mend. "Are you serious?" I replied. "No, I haven't heard anything, but I've also been driving through LA for the past hour and have not looked at my phone or a newsfeed. What happened?" She very nicely explained to me the rumors that had been whizzing around their newsroom, and she was reaching out to me to see if I could shed any light on the situation or just confirm his death. But I couldn't, not without real facts. I knew I needed to call my staff back in New York right away. If Mr. De La Renta had indeed passed away, we had to write his tribute, and fast. I hung up and almost immediately got a call from another CNN producer for Don Lemon, who had the time slot after Anderson Cooper's. Finally, I decided I had to pull over and scan my emails, and that's where I saw one from ABC News. It was true. Mr. De La Renta had died, and my heart sank. I knew I was going to be late for dinner, but this required my immediate attention. It was now a personal and professional situation for me. I'd lost someone I truly admired and respected, but I also had to cover it as news in real time. It was all new territory for me. I dialed one of my editors back home in New York. It was late, but it was also an emergency, and in the internet world, you never stop working. We chatted quickly about what a good man Mr. De Laurentiis was and how the tribute I wrote should be personal because I just couldn't see honoring him any other way. We decided, in an effort to be fast and to get me to dinner on time, I would dictate to this editor while I drove. Multitasking, the story of my life. And my fashion career has always taught me how to handle it well. Just tell me what you remember and love most about him, my editor said. I'll string it together right now and send it back to you to look at. Less than an hour later, I would be sitting at dinner at Bestia when that finished story came through on email. I excused myself and ran to the bathroom. So as not to be rude at the table, of course, scrolled through the text quickly, typed a few notes, and off it went. That memorial tribute would be up on my site and live in less than a minute for hundreds of millions of people to see. Back of the table, though, I confessed. I told Sophia, my dinner partner, about all the balls I had been juggling that night on the way to dinner, and she, of all people, completely understood. If there's one thing the fashion industry prepares you for, it's creative juggling. Wearing many hats, figuratively and literally, is the very foundation of finding success in my industry. And after more than 20 years of laying that foundation in the fashion world, I'm now prepared for the front lines of any battle. Consider me that ultimate style-obsessed, multitasking ninja, nodding and saying yes to everything that crosses my path, and always delivering my best on it. I, and Sophia, know that accomplishment well, a feeling we both really love. After all, she is hashtag girl boss, I am the slashy. For my entire career, in fact, for pretty much my entire life, I've been the ultimate juggler, the multi-hyphenate, the boy who does too much. The year before I launched Yahoo Style, I launched a clothing collection for QVC called Styled by Joe Zee, where I would bring a beautifully designed, trend-driven mix-and-match line to women everywhere. My philosophy was that getting dressed each morning didn't have to be frustrating, but should be fun and chic. And my collection set out to do just that, like I was styling every women's wardrobe each morning. While I was promoting that line, I did a series of interviews, and one particular blogger asked me what it was like to be the ultimate slashy. And bam! That was it. She was right. That single word defined so much of who I was. We are officially living in the slash generation, and thank God fashion had prepped me. If you think about it, it makes perfect sense. In our parents' day, you had one job your whole life where you would rise through the ranks and were proud of the success path you carved out for yourself. And if you had two jobs, well, it meant you were in dire straits and wasn't something to brag about. Today, if you aren't doing multiple things, it becomes a hang your head in shame moment. A recent 30-year-old millennial employee of mine, who only wanted to be hired as a contractor versus becoming a full-time staffer, declared that he or she did not want to be perceived as doing only one thing, even though he or she was. A single job was now taboo. Looking back, I realized I was always this way, even as a kid, an overbooked, overambitious, overzealous overachiever. I'm a person who only feels normal when his head is just short of spinning off into the galaxy, and always have been. Here's my proof. In my formative years, I was a school kid / wannabe piano player / after-school disco dancing student / weekend window shopper / overall know-it-all. In my teens, I was an annoying, hand-raising, first-row sitting student / concert violinist / music arranger / school fashion show producer / yearbook captain / weekend retail guy / part-time busboy / chronic television addict. In my 20s, I moved to New York and everything got bigger. It was here that I could do even more. I found myself filling the roles of a fashion student / intern / school newspaper editor / part-time club kid / self-taught publisher / party promoter / fashion assistant / DJ. By the time I got to my 30s, things were settling in. I was firmly ensconced as a fashion director of W Magazine, and I had discovered the joys of freelance styling, from celebrity red carpets to music videos to major ad campaigns, all at the same time. Here I was, a wide-eyed Toronto kid, living my American dream, with more and more possibilities stacked on top of one another. I look back, and I can say my 30s defined a lot of who I am today, an editor / stylist / marketer / negotiator / celebrity wrangler / wardrobe therapist / networker. In those years, I was just working hard to establish myself in the fashion business. Now halfway into my 40s, the world is changing, and I'm still evolving, with more slashes to add, and I'm proud of that. Here I am, a magazine editor / designer / fashion stylist / TV reality guy / red carpet commentator / school speaker / TV producer / talk show host / blogger / accidental techie / wannabe backup dancer, and yes, now an author too. I know many of you can relate, maybe not necessarily with my zigzag nutty schedule, but to the fact that we have so many things we love to do, and frankly, we're at a time now where we can actually do them all. More than ever, I am so impressed with all the young people I meet whenever I'm interviewing them or working with them, because in so many ways, they remind me of myself. I can see all the amazing possibilities of what that next generation can accomplish, doing incredibly creative multiple things and then sharing it with the world through social media. If there's only one thing that the fashion world trains you for, it's the tackle. For the sake of sounding like a fashion dinosaur living in this slashy gen, I can only speak from personal experiences. While my peers in the industry can be reluctant to embrace change, ironic for a business that prides itself on newness every 6 months, I feel that I have been a person who hasn't always been afraid to take a risk. Jumping in the deep end when I don't even know how to swim, I've learned that my perseverance in tackling what I want to do has become my precious lifesaver. And that's a lesson that feels so prevalent with my younger counterparts. Just look at the average fashion industry's 20-something social media accounts. No one's just a writer anymore, or a stylist. Now they're also bloggers, bakers, digital entrepreneurs, florists, or even cat mothers. Multi-careers are the new black. We wrapped up dinner after discussing Sophia's new brick-and-mortar store and my new job, and said our goodbyes in an old warehouse parking lot with Oscar de la Renta still on my mind. I never did give confirmation to Anderson's show, but that was fine. I got my car to head back to the city, and along the way I got back to work, calling my editor in New York and having her reread me the Mr. De La Renta memorial tribute story that had been posted during dinner so I could dictate some additional edits. That's when my phone rang. It was Becky, the head of communications for Yahoo, and she was calling with a request from Charlie Rose and CBS News. They wanted me to swing by the studios and comment on the incredible legacy of Mr. De La Renta for the following morning show. Of course, I had to say yes. My night might have been crazy and surreal enough, and busy enough, but still, I ran to my apartment, grabbed a suit jacket, and sped over to the CBS News studios, which at 11 p.m. was completely deserted, except for the night crew. I filmed my interview with Charlie and left and made one last pit stop for the night. A drink with my old ELLE colleagues at the Four Seasons Hotel, where they had just hosted their annual Women in Hollywood event hours earlier. I remember arriving there close to midnight and falling into a chair at their table with exhaustion, but also exhilaration. All this has happened, I thought, and it was just 6 hours in my life. In that short time, I had been a reporter / investigator / TV commentator / pundit / copy editor / former magazine guy. What would the next day hold? Much of the same? Something unexpected? More obstacles to jump? New hats to wear? Potholes to maneuver around, or even new successes to champion? Yes to all of the above. And that's why I do and obsessively love what I do. Kat, my editor for this book, knows this so well about me, and she's been incredibly patient as I pushed the deadline and publishing dates for this book 3 times. I would consistently write, call, email, text her. I have one more thing to add. Let's wait for the next big thing coming up. There was always more, and there was always something else I was doing. Finally, I had to say to myself that any more slashes can wait. I was ready. I want to share my rules, my life, my lessons, my insider stories, my tips, my tricks, my triumphs, and my tribulations from the crazy, silly, zany, screwed up, but incredibly creative industry known as fashion. This business didn't just teach me the beautiful and the glamorous rules, but also the ones that allowed me to do and tackle everything I ever wanted to do. Nothing was impossible. I sat at a diner when I first moved to New York in 1990 with a friend of a friend who told me, under no uncertain terms, that I would never make it as a fashion editor, nor would I even be given that opportunity. Those spots, he very firmly declared, were reserved for blonde privileged girls, and I was none of the above. There was no room at the table for a middle-class Asian boy. Well, good thing I don't sleep, and good thing I don't stop, because I think I've proved him wrong. Even the sticker on my laptop, which is permanently open, has a motto, hashtag never not working. And not that I'm preaching, because that's not me, and I know that everyone approaches their passions in a different way. But this book is my personal journey, how I got here, and that's where.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.